In this short video, we're going to discuss the processes that are necessary for hazard reduction burning. Hazard reduction burning is different to backburning. Backburning is the process that we use during a fire emergency to fight fire with fire, where we remove the fuel by burning it out ahead of the main fire front. Hazard reduction, what we're doing here today, is a planned event well in advance of the fire season, generally during the cooler months of the year, where we use it as a fuel management program. By reducing the fuel, taking away different layers of bushfire fuel, we are mitigating the impacts or lessening the impacts of bushfires when they occur. It's also very common to use hazard reduction for ecological purposes.
Hazard reduction is an important part of preparing for bushfires. It helps to protect people, property and the environment. Fire is a natural part of the Australian ecosystem, with many plants and animals adapting to fire over thousands of years. The lack of fire can lead to a change in biodiversity and leads to potentially dangerous fires in the summer months. Fire agencies work collaboratively with land management agencies to formulate a fuel management program in their area and controlled burning operations. There are vast sections of our community that are classified as being bushfire prone. Therefore, where we determine hazard reduction works need to be conducted is based on a risk assessment. We need to focus our attention and emphasise our work on vulnerable communities. The intent is to also have a mosaic pattern or a checkerboard pattern in the bushland environment. We simply can't burn the same patch of bush every single year. The objective of bushfire hazard reduction burning is to reduce fuel loads in the vegetation, therefore minimising the potential impacts of bushfires on life, property and the environment. The characteristics of hazard reduction burning is a low flame height, low scorch height and a low rate of spread. As part of planning for controlled burns, we need to consider the type of vegetation or bushfire fuel, its load and structure within the environment. We need to consider the effects of burning on the environment and the community and ensure there is adequate fire breaks in place. Therefore, there needs to be a structured prescribed burn plan. Part of the environmental assessment is to look at what threatened species are in the area and what cultural, environmental or Aboriginal heritage is in the area. The burn plan will determine how the hazard reduction will be implemented. The detail in the plan will depend on the size and nature and scope of works. It'll include what control lines are required, water sources, refuge areas, and escape routes for firefighters, for example. It's vital that all the crews who are involved with the burning operation have access to the plan and are fully conversant with all of the detail in that plan. The next step is to determine the appropriate season and weather conditions for burning. This includes ensuring that we have the correct temperature, relative humidity, the best wind direction and speed, and atmospheric stability. As part of the burning operation, we need to consider having the appropriate amount of resources for the task at hand. That includes having the right amount of personnel, trucks, machinery, aircraft, and logistical supplies such as feeding arrangements.
So what's happening here is we've created a burnt buffer at the top of the ridge, immediately adjacent to the houses up there. Let that fire burn in nice and slowly, and as you can see, there's been a low intensity fire here which is just creeping down the hill. Crews are then progressing forward, doing a line or spot ignition as we go around the fire trail, using the fire trail as the containment line. We can see that it's a low to moderate intensity because the fire hasn't got up into the canopy, nor has it climbed up the fibrous bark trees. This is precisely the type of fuel management that we want. Let the material burn itself out and create a burnt buffer immediately adjacent to the houses and therefore creating an asset protection zone. So we're now on the bottom edge of the fire. We've got the burnt buffer at the top of the hill. And what the guys are doing here is doing some spot ignition to carry the fire around on the bottom control line. This will then send fire back into the interior, and you can see that the fire behaviour is moving back forward that way. At a low intensity, they're only doing spot ignition. Where those spots come together, you get a bit of a junction zone.
One of the major considerations for hazard reduction burning is considering what type of resources are most appropriate for that particular burn. In this case, we're going to be using aircraft and aerial incendiaries. Incendiaries are used for a variety of reasons, including making sure you've got the right intensity on the burn and allowing you to do spot ignition, carrying the fire across ridge tops and deepening burns where people on the ground or vehicles can't actually get access to.
Yeah, so they simply feed into the machine. I can adjust the rate, and there's a glycol mix in there, so that's injected by a syringe that pierces that and then comes out the chute through the floor of the aircraft. We adjusted the glycol mix so it'll go off today. It's about 100% mix because it's cooler, probably about 30 seconds.
So we're currently working in an area known as the urban bushland interface, where we have houses at the tops of ridge backing directly onto bushland. This can be quite problematic to coordinate a controlled burn because we need to prepare the site well in advance of the burn. So what's happened on this site is we've had control lines or mineral earth lines put in around the assets. So we're using the natural formations to our advantage. So an important part of preparing for a controlled burn is liaising with the neighbours and having the neighbours on board to be part of the operation. It's the responsibility of the landowner to maintain their own property, making sure that the gutters are clear of any leaves and debris, and any wood pile or combustible material that's in the garden or yard has a good clearance zone around it. When we've got smoke and embers blowing towards the house, there's a reduced risk of igniting any of those combustible materials. It's also important that the community and the homeowner works well and works closely with the fire brigade on scene at the time. At this house, we've got hoses deployed, crews down below, but also the residents at home so they know what's going on and they're part of the operation.
Whilst we use the best information and forecasts available, sometimes it's difficult to predict where smoke will spread and what impact it will have on the community. We therefore provide notifications to local residents and ask that they take their normal safety precautions with regards to smoke management.
What we see here is the mid-story vegetation layer or shrub layer that hazard reduction seeks to reduce. Across the trail, a recently conducted hazard reduction burn where the results show that that mid-story layer has been removed and the larger trees remain relatively untouched. Close by, the results of hazard reduction burning from 2 years ago, where the regeneration process is well underway.
Burning is just one way of preparing for bushfires, and it does not completely remove the threat of fire and doesn't remove the need to be prepared. We can't rely on burning alone as the only method of hazard reduction or fuel management. Mechanical clearing is one of the best ways to reduce fuel around assets and homes to create what is known as an asset protection zone. Taking into consideration all the environmental factors, the vegetation can be quite easily removed through mechanical means or by hand clearing. Hazard reduction burning has a strong reliance on having the right weather conditions at the time. Therefore, it's more viable to do asset protection work or mechanical clearing ahead of the fire season on your own property. As we can see, prescribed hazard reduction burning can be detailed and a highly complex operation. It is just one way of preparing for bushfires. It does not completely remove the threat of fire and doesn't remove the need to be prepared. We ask residents to be part of the bushfire management solution in your community.